sediment systems in 2005. So I'm going to start out and tell you a little bit about what Community Crops does and there's some new involved there. We've got a lot more than the city. And then I'll get into how to garden and details on that kind of thing. So Community Crops started out as a community garden project. Everything that we do is to help people grow food. So this is one of our families that gardens with us, Carolyn and Charles. They garden over at the garden right here at 465 years. And they have been gardening with us probably 4 years or so. They grow everything. You can see there's some okra there, and they grow tomatoes and lots of different herbs. And they really like growing huckleberries, which is something from Kenya and Cameroon in Africa, but they can't buy the store here. They also just really like being able to get their kids involved in gardening. They know if they get the kids involved, they can eat those foods and make them all their own. People are thinking about some of the familiar foods from Africa and probably another thing that Carolyn told me that she really likes about the garden is just getting to know people. In the garden, she's got all these people around her gardening and they get talking about all things. So this is a map of all the locations that we have. All over town, we have 15 different community garden sites. So families can grow their own food. They're open to anybody who wants to garden, and the tools and the water are on site for everybody, and we give people as much to spend and what they can use from that. So it's really easy if the first loan of family don't have to put anything into it except their own time, and then they get off to work for that. So this is our Aloe community garden. I'm very familiar with that. My dad is the volunteer coordinator of this one. Kind of just gives you an idea of what the plot looks like, each individual family area, and how they completely different things. The tomatoes are the one thing that almost everybody plants, but otherwise it varies greatly depending on where people are from and what kind of food they like. In addition to the gardening program, we also do a lot of other things to get people eating food that is healthy for them, growing it. Our Growing Farmers Training Program is a way for people who want to actually start their own farm business. They can go out. Come to our training site. We have a whole training series throughout the winter on how to start a farm business, how does a farm business actually work, how do you grow on such a large scale, and then where do you sell it. And then those that are interested can get space in our training farm site and actually then grow more food there. We really work with them and help them to get their business started. And one of the ways that we grow sell, which is a farmer's grow, is for our CSA share. And the CSA stands for Community Supported Agriculture. The idea behind that is if you don't have space for a big garden of your own, we really want your own fresh vegetables all summer long. When you sign up in the spring, we pay for a season worth of vegetables. So that every week you come and you pick up at our pickup site all the fresh vegetables that you picked that day. So you get to start out in the spring eating all the spring vegetables and greens and root crops and beans and in the summer all the tomatoes and peppers and zucchini. And then in the fall you get the winter squash and some of the greens come back and things like that. So it's a really good way to eat seasonally, eat more vegetables, and also support our community farmers. Money that goes right back to them to help them get their business. We also do lots of workshops, how to garden, so we do in-depth workshops on all things like composting and starting a garden, season extension, things like that. And then we also do cooking classes throughout the year on just all sorts of topics. So we'll do everything from how to cook with greens to how to cook soup with lots of fresh vegetables, fresh pizzas, lots of fun things. We really want people to not only grow all this healthy food, but enjoy it as well. And then finally, we do a lot with SNCC. We go out, our main project is Nicole Middle School. We have a big garden huge project around the city, like this year in progress. So we're just trying to help kids learn about gardening. We help them start growing the food, we do cooking with them. Just getting them outside is great, but then also eating those vegetables, because if they grew them, they're much more likely to eat them. It's always fun to watch kids fight over broccoli if they grew it, they want to eat it. So it's a really great way of getting kids more interested. Okay. Before I get into the gardening how-tos and stuff, do you have any questions about community crops? Around this handout, it's basically a reference. It's not anything I'm going to be following, but I want to be able to take notes because there's something to write on. But it's a couple of really good resources that I've found. One is just how to get a vegetable garden started, which is walking through the whole process. And then the last part is a calendar of what you do when you put this out. What you do. So it's a nice reference, I thought. I'm also going to send around a mailing list sign-up sheet for the community garden, or for community crops. If you're interested in getting on our mailing list and finding out about classes that we have coming up, we also do lots of fun events. And then for everybody who signs up on the list, I do a little drawing. I've got a seed packet, some flowers and some vegetables that I'll pick a winner to get them. Okay. So how many of you have grown a vegetable garden before? And how many of you have grown vegetables in containers? How many of you just garden in general, anytime? So feel free to ask questions as I'm talking. We've got a small group, so it's easy to just stop and answer specific questions as I'm talking. So if there's something that you want me to spend a little bit more time talking about, talk about getting a vegetable garden started, just because that process talks through all the different aspects. It'll talk some about how to garden containers and vegetables that do well here in Nebraska. I need a button. So for those of you that garden before, some of this will probably be able to, you know, maybe things that you already know, but might get a little ideas of how things might work better. So in general, just starting a vegetable garden, you want to find a spot that's got ideally 8 hours of sun each day. You can work with six if you're there's things that you won't be able to grow, like peppers and vegetables that really need a ton of sun. An easy way to get water. That's something when we start a community garden, we were always saying, okay, where's the water source? It doesn't work if it's not families in particular that are dealing with lots of other things in their lives, want to grow food, they need to come to the garden and water when they need to. Regular visits from the gardeners, and that's probably the biggest key of why gardens fail, is if you don't get out there, it's not going to work. And that includes on a really hot day in July, you've got to get out there. Early in the morning, you're probably dead. For yourself, but. And it's scheduling, I always think about putting in calves. They don't always remain nice, neat calves. You just start it out. So, you just start that way. So, I always get asked, well, I want to start a garden. How many should I be? I'm going to dig up my whole backyard. No, don't do that. It's really better to start out small. We start gardeners. When they first came up for a garden plot, they had a nice one. We always give them a 10 by 10 plot. 100 square feet, you can grow quite a bit of stuff. You can't grow probably all the vegetables you're going to need for the year, but if you're successful in that first garden, then the next year you can expand it and know what you're doing, and it works a lot better. And also just starting out with a variety of things, let's just try out different things. So don't go We also sometimes just put in raised beds for community gardens. This is our garden at 18th and F, which is our first Presbyterian church community. And we had to build raised beds on this garden because it was a site where the house had been torn down and then just filled with fill dirt, and then it had been parked on. And we really didn't want to try to remediate that soil. So we decided to go up, and so we built raised beds, filled them with our organic compost soil mix, and it worked out really well for the gardeners. We also found that you could see the paths actually stained paths because the gardens were much better to clean. Our community gardeners, like gardeners, always kind of like creeping into the path area. The biggest problem with raised beds is that the soil dries out a lot faster, so you have to water a lot more in the summer. But in the spring, it's nice because it gets warm faster, so it's a trade-off. It's also good if somebody doesn't have a hard time leaning over to be able to get down to the ground, to be able to get a little higher, to get some air pressure. So the advantages for that coming in locations won't work as fast. Container gardening is another way of gardening if you don't have a space. And even if you do, it lets you grow containers that you want to grow or you don't grow. Or it lets you put things in different areas. So, like, for example, things that I put in containers, I would put some pepper trees that I put in containers, I can put them in the fall and kind of overlay into them. Sometimes it's helpful, sometimes it's not, but peppers are a short-lived perennial, so they'll often live for a couple of years. And then that lets me get peppers much earlier in the spring. They don't always get fruit in the winter. I also have some of my herbs in containers, like lemongrass or lemon verbena. They're not cold hardy, and so that's a nice way to kind of overwinter those before they leave and keep them going the whole winter. So even if you have wind, gardening might be another way of gardening. It's also a good way to start things early in the spring, like the pasta strainer bowl of lettuce there. It's kind of a fun thing you can do, you know, this time of year and get some lettuce going before maybe you can get outside and start making a strain in that. So there's lots of different things that can be used for containers. So the two rules that I always give for container gardening is whatever you're growing in has to have a drainage bowl. So easy to water things. It works real plants, whether it's in the soil, outside, or in a container that will drip new air and a lot of water. If there's too much water in there, they're never going to get air. So that's really important. And then using potting soil. The dirt from outside in the ground works great there, but in a container it gets really heavy, so it's hard for you to move the container. But it also can really pack in the container. Another tip that works really well, especially in our lovely hot, dry climate, is to use a plastic pot inside a nice decorative pot. Sometimes you want to use a nice clay pot that looks pretty, but clay pots really fit most of the family. So putting a plastic pot inside of it, packing the insects, area in between with mulch or newspaper or some kind of insulation to keep that lit area cooler. And you can also water that area, and that will help keep the whole thing cooler. So that, you know, once it's still working, that helps you have a plant that you don't have to water completely. Potting soil can be more expensive to buy, so lots of ways you can get around that. One way is if you've got a really big container and you're growing something that's, you know, annual flowers or lettuce or something, it doesn't grow roots that are growing, they don't need as much soil. You know, fill that container with styrofoam peanuts or pine cones or pine needles, something light. So just give it some steps there. And you can also reuse potting mix. When you originally buy potting mix, most of it comes pre-fertilized, so you don't have to worry about fertilizing it. If you want to reuse it, if you can reuse it for a few years, it's still got all the structure in the soil, it's still white, it still works, but it doesn't have the fertilizer that's left to use. So that's the one thing. And there's different types of fertilizers.
I always, if I do it early in the spring, it seems like it doesn't get the roots in the last
year. Vegetables are good. In general, it's good to let them dry first before you put them on. So that they don't, you know, have any problems with that. But, they get more of the beans. Obviously, watering is a big issue. You know, I have containers trying to water twice a day in summer, half summer, that kind of thing. But in the middle of the water can be a problem too. In the spring and fall, when you say that things are well dried out before you water them. The easiest way to check whether something's watered is by weight. If you mix up that pot, you'll be able to feel if it's lightweight, if it's watered. You know, if you're considering something to go to the past the very top way, that can dry out more than the next day. And there's lots and lots of vegetables that can really grow on the containers. There's a smaller variety of tomatoes, peppers, can really grow. And they aren't squashed, which are sad, and they're supposed to be like the lettuce. Then bigger containers, there's mushrooms and stuff like that. So, there's a lot of options on this video. Most of the things lots of people get flowers and vegetables. You know, there's like tomatoes in the middle where you buy flowers. It doesn't have to be a big one. Any questions about containers or things you want to grow in containers? And herbs just want to grow, so they're really good in the container. They do really well. Some of you look like they look good. Okay. So now we'll talk a little bit about growing in the ground. So, start off with, of course, you're starting a brand new bed. So this is a new area of your body you want to explore. So this is the traditional method. Decide how big space you want, lay it out. Fill up the soil, break it out, add compost, fill it in, and then install your irrigation if you're putting in some kind of irrigation system. But that takes a lot of work, number one. The fossil fuels need fiber fillers. All of that is a fine filler and really fun. But it also really disturbs the soil structure. So you're going in and you're taking soil that's full of microorganisms and the earthworms and everything that's in there. You're mixing it all up and you're sending the network of soil that you had in there everywhere, killing the earthworms. And so you have to start and cut it again and make sure that soil can be done. So, next slide. Another alternative that is both easier for you to do and better quality soil. Substitute mulching. That's what it is. Kind of the most common use. And basically, substitute mulching, the idea is to take either cardboard or a lot of newspaper, which is a lay that down on the site that you want to start. So whether it's got grass on it, or it's got leaves, or whatever is growing there. Just cover the whole thing up. And then add compost. If you want to compost the other organic material, compost is probably best. But just a good thick layer of compost, 3 to 4 inches. And then cover that up with your organic materials, straw, grass clippings, mulch of some kind. And then you've got a starting bed ready to go. Ideally, you need it for the fall. It has time to really break down and pull off the grass and everything. It's so much easier to make it. And that's for the next slide. There's a really terrible photo of me, but you know what I had to show before and after, so it's so good. So, I left there in a bed that I built last spring. And I planted tomatoes in it, so what I did was I put down the cardboard, layer of compost, and all the And then, because tomatoes need to heat in the soil, I poke holes into the hardwood and dug a hole right there. So it's going to kind of like, and put it down the soil and cover it back up. And so it started out really well. You know, the metal was thicket through, they were all covered with the hardwood. Lots of good soil structure down there for the tomatoes, and it just looks well. So you can see the picture on the right. When you harvest it at the end of fall, try to find every single tomato I could just in the cross pit kind of fit. And they obviously did quite well. And it wasn't, and I hardly had to do anything to that bed. Watered the tomatoes a little bit, so it was established, and that bed was as long as it sounds, and it was really amazing. So it's a really easy way to start a garden. And as I said, when you're ready to start planting, you're ready to go, and you can go ahead and keep it. Lots of other things work perfectly well with this. You can use potatoes. Mulching method, just put the potatoes, sweet potatoes right on top of the cardboard, and they'll grow from there. More shallow root things, like I've started strawberry beds this way, I've already put they don't need to be dug down into the dirt, it's just kind of right in the compost. And by the end of the garden season, that cardboard is completely broken down, and you can't even tell it was over there. As long as you just want to make sure the cardboard will be covered up well so it can dry out fast. Questions or thoughts on sweet mulching? Generally not. Once it's established, then I just let it go. It's just to get it started. So I had grass there that I needed to show off. So we'll just go in there. I don't need to worry about it. I also don't till ever. Every year I don't need to till. I've added compost to my soil, and so I can just start planting every year. I think that's something that kind of brings everybody who's got to till every year. But it's really better for the soil if you don't. It's the same thing, you've got the soil organisms and everything that's built up in there anymore, and you've got as intact as possible. Sometimes you have to get it a little bit, but it's as much as you can get it. So,
thank you.
messy to put in there, that, you know. And like if you're planting a little onion, you know, where if it's nice flat soil, you can pour your hose through it, and you, like, you can feel your onion in there.
Yeah, I mean, generally I will rake off anything, like if I'm doing something like that, I'll rake it off. Thank you. new things every year, but I grew turnips for a while. And some of those, I don't like turnips. I'm feeling tiny. They're very susceptible, but I'm like, I finally gave myself permission to stop. So. kind of a similar on how, when do you plant things, what methods do you use? In general, if something's got a big tree, those are the things that you will plant directly in the garden. The things that do well around here, trees, I left those off the ground in the winter, like two or three of them, so something like plant in March and April. Beans, corn, okra grows really well here. We have lots of African gardeners, so it's kind of okra. In general, it's easier to create your root crops. Things are leafy crops, you can do it either way, you can plant it or plant it directly outside. And then of course there's things like potatoes, those are also like set out in the cooler season, although you can get them started anywhere in the cold days and they're pretty happy. They do really well here. Potatoes are really easy crop to grow, they don't do much to grow at all. Asparagus is another fairly easy crop to get started, but that's a perennial, so you have to have space to dedicate it to a long period of time for asparagus. And then garlic is another easy thing to grow. That's when we start that in the fall, just putting out the bulb of garlic. If you plant that will go in a few heads. You harvest in about 2 weeks and a half. So they're nice ones. You really don't have to worry about them all, at all. You can just do all and and then things to transplant that can do really well here, cover the eggplant for tomatoes. Sweet potatoes, the only thing that I've learned from our African gardeners, do really well here. They just vine out a beautiful plant. They use a lot of planters because it's such a gorgeous vine that you actually grow business. Kids love to be real, and things like cavity boxes in general, like using other things to start really learning. Things like peppers and eggplant potatoes, you can start them with seed directly in your garden. The problem is, you just don't have ornamental garden seasons. And they're a central American crop that where they're from, it's very easy to start year round growing season. We just don't have enough time to plant them. So they're a little easier to start them with. Any questions about specific things that you want to grow and how they're best planted?
With asparagus, I started a patch a couple years ago. We got some of the last year that just grew up in the water. You just let it.
So with asparagus, yeah, basically when it first starts growing in the spring, you just start cutting some of the spears, but then just letting it grow, like you said, all summer long, you're getting energy from it. For the next year. So, yeah, just let it grow all season long. You can cut it down in the fall. Once it's indefinitely done, it's all done. You can let it reseed, but you're not going to get really good from it. So, I'm going to put that up. A pretty big container. I mean, their root system doesn't go down too much, but the tubers, I mean, you're not going to get as big as tubers.
Yeah.
But I would say at least 7 gallons a year. Just a few tips on starting seeds in the garden. You want, as I said, work the soil as quick as you can, probably don't work the soil. For starting seeds, you know, that first inch or two, you want to make sure it's loose. That's really the first thing. So, the seed doesn't have to work too hard. It's good to start off with the soil already being a little moist when you plant the seeds, so that when you go to water, there's more moisture in there, but you know that it's down where you got to start the seeds are dying to moisture. If you're going to leave the water, sometimes they're a little stomach to plant the seeds quite too soon, if you're tired of the seeds. So the bigger seeds need to be planted deeper. But the seeds have to be planted deeper. So you can see what the steps is. If you're planting something in the spring when it tends to be moister, you don't have to plant them out of the seed. In the summer, sometimes they'll plant these a little deeper than what the cabbage says, just so that the moisture content of the soil will again be a little better for the next season in the summer. Any major soil, season, it's not according to what the seed packet says. And just kind of gently get the soil down and then water it. Water can or soft mixture on a spray, and it's really just a gentle water, really thoroughly watered. And never let it dry out. That's probably the hardest part. Carrots are one where people assume that carrots can make it dry ever. It's a tiny little thing. So if it's going to be dry, sometimes I'll put like a board down or something and just moisten the soil. But in general, starting is pretty easy. There's many ways to do it. That's one of the things that you have to do on them. You know, just a few tips from starting with this plant. First step is always to make sure you harden off your plant. As kids probably do, I bet it's you. You go to the store, you buy these great plants and they're beautiful, and you come home and you stick them in the dirt, and they die. And you can say, living in this wonderful, nice, climate controlled environment, out of the sun and that nasty Nebraska wind, they're just not tough enough to handle the outside world. So just always give them a few days to acclimate. When I bring my plants from my farm on my own basement and bring them up, and give them a few hours outside to start with, maybe in a north area of Texas and Illinois, they just start to acclimate. And then start slowly giving them more time to sun, starting to get them in. And it's actually in the plants, the cell structure is changing. And maybe that is actually getting tougher to handle that extra stress that could be the system. And then once the plants are used to being outside, sitting in the sun over a few days, or if you've got a nice cloudy day, and then you get peeked out a little bit, then those are going down and they'll be much better and recover much sooner. Joyce wants time not hold the stem of the plant when you're transplanting it. Probably do. But using holding onto the leaves or the root area, because the plant only has one stem. It can't replace that stem inside its mouth. It can only replace the leaves if it breaks off. So trying not to hold on to the stem. Tomatoes are one of the plants that you want to plant really, really deep. If you've got a large tomato plant, you can plant it half that depth. The whole stem is really in there. It depends how the plant looks. If it's kind of lost in the world, it uses a soil up there. The reason for this is tomato plants have what are called Thank you. So I basically got two piles going, so I've got one that I'm actively putting stuff in and one that's sitting over the winter, and then the spring that I will clear out for the use. And you can, there's a couple of examples of some compost bins. You can set up whatever works for you. Nice to have a container to keep the pile a little bit clean. The fast composting method is putting in a lot of material at once, so a lot of green stuff, a lot of brown stuff, and then mixing it regularly. And that works well, and it does break down and create compost. The hard thing is that we don't have enough to do that at once. We don't have enough material. So if you really need it, enough, you know, three by three pile of stuff to get that going, and then you have to do it that much at once. For composting, I put in plant matter. I won't put in, if I need to start the seed, I wouldn't put it in, and I won't put in the dandelion and brook, because that won't keep going. But anything else, after seeds, leaves, everything comes out of the kitchen, all the vegetables, fruit peels, all that sort of stuff, comes out of the compost. And that's why the other thing is, you know, got some of the good soil, you can add some soil and keep it. You can also, if you don't want to set up a compost bin, just, you've got a place in your garden, you can just bury those too. And it'll, the soil, the sort of living will break it down and you can just grow that way. So, you don't have to do a compost pile. You don't have to start a new area. If you want to start a new bed, you start putting the compost stuff in that area and once you're ready to go with your skin. A few vegetables are easier to start with. Okay. And then lastly, I've got a few events coming up. We have a plant sale every year, so we have a primary event. And we work with somebody to start all plants. They're all organic, they're all just fun varieties of vegetables. They have dozens of varieties of tomatoes, lots of different peppers, and all sorts. Every year we hear back from people in the summer, their plants were the best ones we had, and they did really well. So it's a fun place to come and talk to gardeners and learn as well as get familiar with their plants. And then we have a few classes coming up. We're going to do one that's on the street mall thing I talked about, so we'll do a full Monday post on that. And we're going to do one on how to get kids out gardening. And then we'll also try to get people to get chickens in their backyards. You can have chickens in the city, no roosters. So it's a class on how to get kids out of the city. That's my contact information. Our Facebook page has a lot of updates on everything that we have going on and stuff that's coming up, some interesting articles. All right, so the winner of our team is Bill. We've got a few crop brochures up here if anybody's interested. Thank you.